And what should we do?
I think so. I think we can stay at alert level 3 and allow people to take more responsibility for what their health is going to be. The positivity rate is just too high that I don't think there's very much government can do at this point as far as restrictions are concerned and things like those. It's really up to us to wear our tight-fitting masks, to make sure we don't go to congested, not well-ventilated areas, and to make sure we are clean in general. These are about all we can do, particularly if we are already fully vaccinated. If we are not yet fully vaccinated, that is what we should be doing. We should be getting our vaccines.
How about the mass testing proposal? We've been hearing this for so long, especially early during the pandemic. And again, when we talk about mass testing, we're not saying that each and every Filipino should be tested for COVID-19. But the push is more about increased testing, more than what we have been doing now daily. What do you think? What do you think is the problem? Why we haven't increased the testing that much? Although tumaas na naman talaga siya kumpara to dati.
At the moment, I think we are testing at our full capacity. I don't think that we can increase it very much more. The highest number of tests that we ever achieved in one day was about 85,000 tests, and we're just there. I don't think we're going to be able to go to even 150,000, and I don't think it's going to make that much difference at this point. Everybody that you meet, one out of every two will test positive anyway. So just assume everybody's carrying the virus and make sure that you do everything in order not to catch it.
Okay, so that would be a good perspective for people.
Yeah,
assuming that you test, exhibit certain symptoms, just assume that you might have the variant at least.
I think so, yeah. And if we do certain tests, we should do the ones that are not RT-PCR at this point, but the more rapid tests, the ones that will provide us the results as quickly as possible. Because what's the use of waiting for 2 or 3 days for an RT-PCR result? By then you're sick. And you have infected just about everybody that you're going to infect, because the transmissibility of this virus is so high and does it so early in the game that even contact tracing is not going to do very much these days, not for the Omicron variant.
So once you exhibit certain symptoms, isolate right away and
just assume that you have
contact as much as possible.
Yes.
How about the remedies? What can you do at home without necessarily going to the hospital? Because there's also the possibility of transmitting the virus in case you have it, right? During your travel from home to the hospital, and then you're sent back, right?
Oh, the hospital is a very dangerous place to be these days, because even our healthcare workers are possible carriers and possible sources of transmission to us. They're all getting sick, and they're being required to go to work even when they're still sick and when they're still positive for the virus. So stay away from hospitals as much as you can. Fortunately, this particular variant produces a milder form of disease, and the overwhelming number of us do not need to go to the hospital. And we can stay at home and take care of ourselves there. And in a few days, we are going to be well.
Okay, let's also put in perspective certain studies or claims that this could be the beginning of the end. Hopefully, kung totoo, diba sana. But let's put that in context. Is that exactly unfounded, or there's good basis to say that in case we hurdle this particular surge, we might be looking at better things afterward?
Yes, it is not unfounded, Christian. And I'm hoping that that is going to become the reality later on, because this virus is so transmissible, but produces a very mild type of disease compared to the Delta variant and the original virus, for example, that even if it infects a lot of us and increases our tendency to natural herd immunity, it will not make people die. So I hope that soon there will be no one that the virus will be able to infect, because everybody has been infected already.
By this milder variant of
milder variant, yes.
Okay, but of course, that is not to say that we can take this for granted and let our guard down.
Absolutely not. Because even as we say that it is mild, there are still people who die. It's just a matter of proportion. It's milder, but it can be serious too.
Okay, so naturally, once you contract the virus, you would develop antibodies afterward, right? That's what you call the natural immunity. But what if, because this virus, according to a lot of experts, still remains very much unpredictable or full of surprises? So what if after Omicron, another variant comes up, but it's even more virulent than Delta and perhaps just as transmissible as the Omicron variant? How would that affect us?
It is a possibility that we will have another variant like that, and let's hope that doesn't happen. It's not something within our control. It's just something that we need to prepare for. However, if you look at the history of viruses, those that are highly transmissible are usually milder than the ones that are less transmissible. And those that are less transmissible are usually more virulent than the ones that are highly transmissible. So it is a toss-up between, do you want to get it and get it over with, or not get it and just remain disease-free and hopefully no other variant comes that is going to infect you.
Okay. Again, just to put that in perspective, because some people who are watching us might misconstrue that. Baka isipin, ah, ganun ba? Okay na siguro magpahawa ako para magkaroon ako natural immunity. We're not saying that.
No, we're not saying that, of course. Just get yourselves vaccinated. That is going to help reduce your chances of getting serious Omicron COVID disease.
Okay, let's also put in perspective, I've been seeing this on social media, people asking this very basic question. How come we already were able to vaccinate a good number of Filipinos, millions of them, although we haven't reached that target, right? Pero marami na, at nagkaroon tayo ng supposedly population protection in Metro Manila, but how come marami pa rin ang nahawa? Let's go back to the basic discussion as to what vaccines or can actually do to us. Na hindi naman talaga ibig sabihin na hindi ka mahahawa.
In this particular instance, the vaccines that have been developed more reduces the severity of the illness that we get rather than prevents us from getting the disease. It does prevent us from getting the disease to some extent, but the most important characteristic of the vaccine that we have is that it will prevent us from getting serious disease.
Okay. And
prevent
and this is what
us
we're
from
now.
Getting hospitalized or dying.
So in short, the fact that a lot of Filipinos have been vaccinated already, many of us have been boosted, this is one of the reasons or among the reasons why many have not been hospitalized. Tama po ba?
Yes, the vaccine is protecting us. That's the reason why the number of cases are not as many as we used to see in proportion to the number of cases. The number of hospitalized cases is not as many as we used to see. It is because we are being protected by the vaccine.
Okay. Another thing, early during the pandemic, I remember you made critical comments about the handling of the pandemic. And honestly, you were frustrated at certain points, right? Now, looking back, we've been into this for more than 2 years now. How do you see the overall handling of our government agencies of this entire pandemic episode so far?
I still feel the same way. I think that they have been trying to do their best, but up to now, it hasn't been good enough. Part of the reason is because the virus is an enemy that is very unpredictable, but also partly because we do not learn the lessons that we should be learning from the experience that we have had. We have had 2 years of experience with this. So this the problem is the same. Testing, tracing, the speed by which we get antiviral agents or vaccines, things like this. It's the same problem for the past 2 years. So I'm still as frustrated as I was before, but I would like to give some leeway, let's put it that way, to the Department of Health and to the government because of the unpredictability of the virus. Every time we think we are in a better place, the virus tells us, no, not yet, you're not.
Okay, and I suppose part of the experience was the problem with the supply or the number of healthcare frontliners, right? That's why lately we've heard this suggestion, this new policy direction to shorten, if not do away, with the conventional quarantine period for infected healthcare workers as long as they show no symptoms. What do you think of that?
Yes, well, they're following the CDC guidelines. The problem is the CDC guideline is for everybody, not just health workers, but for the general public. In the Philippines, we have dichotomized this particular policy, and we have put the general public in the usual quarantine period of 10 days and put the healthcare workers in the shorter quarantine period of 5 days. So now the healthcare workers are complaining and saying, why are you doing this to us? Are we less important than the general public that you want to protect the public for 10 days and we can only be protected for 5? So that's one aspect. And the other thing, however, is now the public is going to ask when the first few cases of COVID transmission from a positive healthcare worker to a non-COVID patient happens, they're going to ask, why did you let these healthcare workers go to work and infect us? So there are many problems with the policy that they have made, and they have to explain it to us so that we understand that the risks are added, but that we need to accept it for these following reasons that they should tell us.
How do you think this could be improved? Or are you supporting this policy direction so far, as long as it is properly explained to the public?
I think that they should do, if they follow the CDC, they should follow what the CDC says, which is for the general public, the quarantine period is shortened to 5 days because the transmissibility of the virus is most during the first 3 days of illness, and after that rapidly declines, so that the risks after the fifth day are acceptable, not just for the general public, but also for the healthcare workers.
In short, lahat na. Follow the CDC guidelines.
Either 10
healthcare
days
workers and the rest of the public.
Days lahat.
Okay. Former Health Secretary Esperanza Cabral, thank you very much for joining us tonight, ma'am. Always a pleasure to have you on the program.
Thank you, Christian. Good night.
Good night, po. And before we go, social media was set abuzz after a Philippine transport official posted on her Facebook page that her newly hired helpers stole her money and jewelry amounting to over 1 million pesos. While some were sympathetic, other netizens were sarcastic, even asking the transport official to move on from the incident, an apparent reference to the lines used by the supporters of presidential candidate Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Some used the argument that the helper was able to do many things anyway, and some users even suggested that the official hire the offspring of the maid. Some users also said there's still no final criminal conviction against the helper. In a separate post, the transport official thanked those who expressed their support, saying she only posted about the incident to warn other people. So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. For recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow, after the fact.